in this episode.
I learned that it's not a good idea to try and make friends with anyone who has big eyebrows, because behind the scenes, they're probably up to no good, killing people, stealing whistles and stuff.
Welcome. You're listening to Paleo Cheese Podcast, episode 12, part 2, Just Before Dawn with Dan Padovana.
All right, so Just Before Dawn. This is a movie that Dan picked. He gave us three of them. This is the one we chose. And it is from 1981. It's about a group of friends who travel out to some remote woods in Oregon where one of them has inherited property. In typical slasher fashion, they're warned a few times heading out there, but they go anyway. And this turns into a bad decision for the group, unaware that they'll be fighting for their lives, their makeup, and their whistle necklace. And it's directed by Jeff Lieberman, who, as I mentioned earlier, wrote and directed Squirm, which I just recently saw. And it was written by Mark Arowitz and Jeff Lieberman. This is the only thing Mark has written. He's acted in it, I think, in a few things. And then it stars most notably George Kennedy and Greg Henry. Mm-hmm. Most of the cast went on to do some popular TV shows before and after. Even, what was it? Greg Henry's like in Guardians of the Galaxy and some other big stuff.
It was interesting to see how many of them were actually on similar shows.
Oh, you mean like Knots Landing and, oh yeah.
And I thought, you know, Dallas, Murder, She Wrote, a couple of them were on Perry Mason, The Rifleman. But then you had some, like, one was on In Living Color, as well as Highway to Heaven. And I thought, I'm like, oh, look at that. So, and Batchel was on Dukes of Hazzard. Yeah, man.
We're back to
and Laverne and Shirley and Knight Rider. I'm like, that guy's really rocking it. And he did a bunch of voice stuff too, like Happy Feet and Babe. You know, Megan wasn't so, I mean, she did some stuff, but it was more like Walker, Texas Ranger and Atlas Shrugged 2. And I'm just like, oh man. But, you know, interesting character though. I thought she did pretty good in this movie.
Yes.
This was Dan's suggestion. And, you know, a lot of people, I think we've mentioned this before. I know we mentioned it before the show, but, you know, one of the things that we like to do is, you know, a lot of people, come on, you know, people like Dan or Mallerman or Lansdale or, you know, any of these individuals, they do a bunch of shows, you know, and they go on. And a lot of times, you know, not to knock on anybody, it's human nature, right? I mean, it's on radio. I've done it, you know, where you have people on. And it's kind of the same questions. You know, it's a lot of the same. It's hard to be original, you know, and to throw something out there that really gets somebody on their toes or thinking or outside the box. And so we thought, well, we want to have people on, but what are we going to do? And we said, well, why don't we review a movie with them, talk to them about books and what they're doing in their life. That's just kind of everyday stuff. Kind of like Dan talks about where he says, how did you state it, man? Let me see here. I got it. When you read one of my books, I want you to feel like you're sitting around a campfire with me at midnight. The sweet smell of wood burning, the fire crackling like a bullwhip, and a full moon chasing the shadows back to the woods. Just remember to save me a marshmallow. I like mine light brown, like cinnamon toast. And I thought, that's what we're trying to do with the show. we are. And so, but the idea is like, well, look, let's have them on. And at first it was like, well, we'll give them three ideas. I think we did that with Mallerman. Right. We gave him three suggestions for movies. And I think he picked November. And it was really cool. But then Chad, I think, is the one who came up with this idea to say, why not let them pitch the three? And so you gave us three, man. What, name those three for us there, Dan, the three that you proposed.
OK, so I threw out two, which are definite cheese. Humongous, which I believe was either 80 or 81. The Funhouse, which was Tobe Hooper. Which I believe was also around 80 or 81. And then there was this one, Just Before Dawn, which is not easy to find, as we mentioned at the outset. So I wasn't sure which one you'd end up picking. I was kind of hoping you'd go with this one. The other two would definitely be fun from a cheesy standpoint to have some fun with. But this one, I've been interested in slashers since I saw Halloween, you know, back in the late 70s, early 80s. And I probably went through all those movies back then, but somehow this one passed me by. I never saw it in the theater. I sincerely doubt it came to my hometown. I don't recall seeing it on HBO or any of those pay channels back in the day. Somebody happened to mention it to me on a horror board, I'm going to say 15, 20 years ago. And immediately I heard, oh, okay, well, 1980, 81, that was like, you know, before things really got out of control and got stupid in the slasher genre. That was kind of like the golden era. If it's from that era, I definitely want to see it. And just about everybody raved about it. So I found it on DVD and I immediately fell in love. And it's far more than a slasher movie. It's definitely a cut above the normal, you know, pun completely intended. I think the direction is fantastic. I think there's excellent symbolism all the way through. And it's just, you know, creepy as fuck, too. You know, it does what a horror movie is supposed to do.
Have you read the story? It's based on a story by Joseph Middleton. And I guess
that I didn't know.
Yeah, it's right at the beginning of the film. It says it in the credits at the beginning. And I made sure to write it down real quick. I'm like, because, you know, I don't want to jump the gun on that. So I won't say anything more about the beginning just yet. But I saw that and I'm like, you know, so I had learned that apparently the original story is what the original script had to do with. It's cultic, right? It's got voodoo. There's a snake and demons and stuff. And some of that original script stuck in there, which is why you end up having curious characters, the yokel locals on the mountain talking about the devil rise and stuff. Yeah. You know, that is the leftovers from the original script that was based more directly on the story by Joseph Middleton. But I'd never heard of this movie. I'd never read the book. And now I'd love to, you know, I don't know, because they say it's so different. They say that's what the director, he said, I'll do this movie on one condition, and that is that I can dramatically change it. So, yeah. So I don't know. I mean, you know, I don't know if I'd like the book as much as I do the film.
Yeah, it was about, I think, about some kind of like voodoo curse that had to do with like twins. And they mentioned that some of the dialogue was kept in the movie from the original manuscript, which leaves you like all of the, you know, oh, it's a demon and the devil rising and stuff, which kind of doesn't make sense unless you know what was there before. And then there was even mention of, you know, like when they're going down the road and they see a set of twins, they're like, why are there so many twins around here? Well, that was left over from the, you know, thing. But when I watched it the other day, I'd never seen it before, never heard of it before. Was totally down for watching it. My initial thoughts within the first 10 minutes were like, the movie itself doesn't have a lot of soundtrack. It just has, but it's got that kind of whistling noise. And it's got some real ominous, you know, ambience going on and everything. But as far as music, there's really not a whole lot. But right at the beginning, there was a cool like synth wave, like Tangerine Dream type of song that was played beneath that like whistle and the sunset and stuff. And I thought, oh, that's a really cool song. I hope there's more of it in the movie. And there wasn't, but which was a little disappointing, but I did like all of the rest of the kind of ambience and stuff. And even though the opening scene with the guys at the church, they're supposed to be fixing up the church or whatever. At first, when I was watching it, I was like, okay, this is fairly typical so far. These guys are kind of, you know, they're drunk, they're kind of silly, but I felt like they're right off the bat, their dialogue was a little bit more intelligent, even just for being dumb dialogue, because I've seen a lot of slashers and the writing is not good in most of them. The dialogue is not good. The acting is not good. And I suppose maybe that's one of the reasons why people enjoy them, you know, because you can point and laugh, but also, I don't know if anyone gets scared of anything like that nowadays, but at least from the old ones. But you can enjoy and kind of know what to expect. But at the same time, something like this comes along and, you know, the scene with the guys in the church, and the one dude looks up and sees this creeper looking at him.
Yeah.
And I'm like, all right, I don't have to wait to see this thing. He's not in a, you know, first person view through a bush with a heavy breathing, which has been done to death. You know, they just showed me this dude. And not only that, but the victim, the soon to be victim, saw him too. That doesn't happen ever either. It's usually a bush moving or a shadow going by or something like that. So when I saw that, I was like, I think this is probably going to be a little bit different. I was really pleased by that, like right off the bat, seeing that done like that. And it was kind of unsettling too, in part of that probably had to do with the fact that I wasn't expecting it to go down like this.
In some ways, it has some standard cliche stuff. I mean,
For sure.
It is the first time I've ever seen a machete to the crotch.
Yeah.
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 Right out the bunghole.
It was the type of thing from, you know, from the early 80s where, you know, for the shock value, and they definitely went for it.
Yeah. At first I was like, oh, okay. Yeah. He stuck him in the gut, whatever. And then they showed him behind. No. I was like, oh, that wasn't his gut.
No, dude.
He's getting a serrated prostate exam right yes. now.
Oh, dude, the serrated knife too. And that, yeah. and that voice, and it was so creepy. That voice. And it was like kind of when it's coming out, it was sawing at it. And I'm thinking, dude, bro, like this is like, I was down, you know, I was downstairs in my office, man. It's lit up nice and pretty right now. But man, I turned off all the lights and stuff, and I'm watching. And as I already said, man, I haven't watched a lot of scary movies. So I'm kind of still the kid who has never seen anything like this.
You're not quite as desensitized.
No. And so when I saw homeboy peeking through that hole in the roof, man, I was like, bro, my hair just kind of went white. And I said, oh, this is weird, dude. And the thing, it wouldn't have been as creepy to me if it was like a scary clown. You know what I mean? Like, scary clowns freak me the crap out. I'm not down with that. But that dude up in that hole was like kind of a normal guy, but you could tell he was messed up. Like, something ain't right with this dude up there. What's he doing up there? Why is he peeking down? But the conversation, like you're saying, for one, I loved the music in the beginning. I thought that was awesome. And I thought that the sounds, which were mostly natural and classical instruments, and some of it was just the guy who did it made noises even with his own mouth, right? And then just kind of put him to a... Yeah. And I thought that was cool. But the conversation, I thought, was great, you know, because, you know, they got one of them's drunk, or maybe they both are. But one of them is really hammered. Okay. He's like totally trashed. And he looks up there and he sees, like you're saying, he's the victim, and he sees the dude up in the hole, and he's freaking out. He goes, there's something up there. And the guy goes, amen, Uncle Ty. Amen. Like this. And but it was so, I could imagine that in a real conversation in that place. And I said, that is believable, you know, and within the first 10 minutes, you got the cool sun scene and stuff. You got the weird kind of dystopian trip there with the kids, the twins, in this car that's all wrecked, like a almost third world looking, you know what I mean? You know, and so it's kind of creepy and everything, but then, you know, you got the creepy guy, you got the knife to the crotch and bunghole, and then you've got the truck being pushed down and it hits the tree, and I loved it, man. And that's maybe the tackiness, a little bit of cheese in it, where that bugger just explodes. Like, the punch is like
big time.
You know, and I said, yeah, I'm like, nobody would drive. Like, people, it's like, you know, maybe this was before Nader. You know what I mean? Like, Nader's like, he's like, look, man, I watched this movie.
Hey, you come into your driveway a little bit too quick. You know, you kind of tap the drive. Boom, that's it. That's it. Well, you never, you know, those Fords are terrible.
You know, there's something to be said about, and I've brought this up before. I don't know if I've brought it up on the podcast, but there's something to be said about scary things happening in the daytime. And I would argue that they can be much, much scarier than when they happen at night. And it's because, to me, when something happens at night, there's hope for the morning. There's hope for the daylight to make things right and make things better. But when it's as bad as it can get, and it's daylight, and you've only got night to look forward to, and crap's hitting the fan in the middle of the day, and a lot of the scarier, more unsettling scenes and the deaths happen right in broad daylight. And so, you know, it'll only get worse.
Yeah.
It's a good point. Yeah. Very good point.
Like those, Jeremiah and I've talked about those ghost hunting shows. They rely heavily on the dark. I mean, they shut the lights off to like, kind of like, get in some manipulating mode of being scared. It's like, we really need the lights off to hear a ghost? You know, it's more about just setting the mood. this movie didn't play that game. And that's another thing that really set it apart from a lot of other slashers. You know, the killings almost always happen at night or in dark areas or whatever. And this just wasn't the case, with the exception of, you know, some things were happening, but for the most part, most of it happened right there in broad daylight.
No, I think in a lot of ways, the movie probably resembles Deliverance more than does like Friday the 13th.
That's what he was going for.
Yeah.
The director was going for he claims to have not seen Texas Chainsaw, or
we called it Texas Chainsaw Murders.
Okay. Right.
So yeah. He wasn't even like really aware of the title.
Right. Everybody ended up at that time, I guess they compared it to Friday, and he hadn't seen that either. And I believe him. I don't think it resembles Friday that much, except for the fact that it's a backwoods slasher.
Yeah. And they were also comparing it to, what's the one with Michael Berryman who plays Pluto? I can't remember the name of the movie. They remade it. There's a couple of them. The Hills Have Eyes, I think is what.
Hills Have Eyes. Oh, yeah.
But he hasn't. He claims to have not seen that either. And, you know, Friday the 13th came out in, what, 80?
80.
And they were filming this in 80. You know, maybe it wasn't even showing by the time, you know, everything was written or anything. But to me, there was just no, except for the fact that it took place in the woods and that there were, you know, younger adults that were getting together to do something. I just don't see any kind of comparison. And I would argue it's better than Friday the 13th, the original one.
They're very different movies, obviously. Yeah. Friday the 13th is almost like a nonstop party. Where, you know, you see it with your friends and you jump at all the jump scenes and the popcorn goes flying. Whereas Just Before Dawn is if you really want to be creeped out and feel like you have no hope, this is probably the movie you watch. So it's a totally different demographic, I think, that they're targeting, although they ended up getting both lumped as slashers.
So you don't think that they were, because of the cast, were essentially the same age as the people that were murdered in Friday the 13th?
True. Yeah, I mean, it is the same deal, you know, send the teenagers out to the woods and they get hacked. Mm-hmm. But Friday the 13th, even though the first two to me are absolute horror classics and a ton of frickin' fun, just so much fun to watch, they were written as, well, I know we can't be Halloween. I know we cannot be that brilliant. Mm-hmm. Let's get outlandish. Let's get Tom Savini and let's just make the most crazy scenes and just have a blast with this. And we'll get people to jump out of their seats. And so to me, it's like a roller coaster ride. It's just a lot of fun. And there are some good scares, but it's not really horrific in the way that like The Shining is horrific or The Exorcist is horrific or even Just Before Dawn is horrific.
I think the reason why I like it so much more than Friday the 13th, and don't get me wrong, I'm a huge Friday the 13th fan. I love all of them, with the exception of
the Manhattan one you love.
Oh, gosh. Anyway. Yeah. I felt like after seeing so many slashers, you know, and just having so many of them be the same and all of the same tropes, you know, from Bloody Valentine to Friday the 13th to... For me, Halloween is a standout. I mean, nothing beats that. I've got definitely a special place that in my heart for that. Just the enigmatic nature of Michael Myers not speaking, and that plain mask just really did it for me. But I just felt like, I guess I was just kind of blown away that I hadn't heard of this, and that it didn't do so many of the things that the other ones. You know, I already mentioned about everything's in daylight, but there's no jump scares. They do quite the opposite. They allow the viewer to remain in the suspense because the victim, you know, the waterfall scene where you see that guy in you know, beyond, just barely beyond the waterfall, or one of the best scenes ever when that chick's getting fondled and she looks off and sees her boyfriend on the shore. It's like, you know, neither one of those were jump scares. There was another scene where the guy's creeping around with a lantern and you see the guy behind him. In Friday the 13th and at Halloween, all of the bodies are discovered through a jump scare. All of the people are killed through a jump scare. I thought it was much creepier to just see something and they go, oh man, I felt like it was handled better and just much more intelligent. It was refreshing for me being a fan of slashers and to not be bored by it. Even though I like slashers a lot, I get really bored with the whole creeping down the long hallway and looking behind doors and then go to the next one and looking. I get really bored with that. And this didn't do that either. So, and if it did do it, you got to see what was going on. Yeah. You know, it wasn't some cheap scare.
Underwater fondly thing is kind of a, like an urban legend type deal. It's almost the hook for the hand story.
Right.
Actually, I think the movie that is comparison would be best comparison is there's a scene in The Haunting from 1963 where one of the characters, the females, is she thinks she's holding her boyfriend's hand, I think, but he's on the other side of the room.
Yeah.
And it's like, if I'm not holding your hand, whose hand am I holding? You know, is that, yeah, just, you know, the thing that it just sends, you know, shivers down your spine when, so it's a great scene. And of course the cinematic, you know, portion too, where he falls, you know, down from the waterfall and into the water.
Yeah.
Is gorgeous. Really gorgeous.
I like that. And the scene where the big reveal of the twins, where the chick is watching after dude gets killed, she's watching through the window and seeing the dude mess with the camera or whatever. And then behind her, you see another dude looking just like him.
Yeah.
And that was awesome. That was awesome reveal.
I didn't know
what
the
shot.
Heck this was. I thought it was like, is he a spirit? Like, I wondered, like, is this dude like a ghosty monster? Like, what's up with this? And, you know, I mean, like, I think the closest thing to that misdirected fondling, not knowing exactly what's going on thing that I've ever seen in a movie was Planes, Trains, and Automobiles. And that wasn't scary. Like, is your hand between two pillows? You know what I mean? Like, that's not even close to
the same. Those aren't pillows.
Those aren't pillows. Ah! And so, like, you know, but to see... To see this, man, and it was what had me, I mean, I was biting my nails the whole time, man. I mean, I'm just probably raw at this point on my hand. I need Band-Aids. But, like, the thing is, what got me is that over and over and over again, there would be, like, for example, the RV, which is super dope, by the way. I kind of miss that, those things. I like that.
It was like style. It was like a Battlestar Galactica RV.
Yeah, and it's going up this super narrow road and stuff. I'm like, man, they're off-roading with that bad boy. You know, it's like MC Hammer at a music festival I went to got stuck in the mud doing something like that with his big bus. But, you know, the thing is like the bad guy jumps on the back of it. And you know that happened, but you don't know what's going to come up. And I kept thinking, like when they would go in, oh, I forgot my glasses, and they go in, I'm just thinking, oh, boy's toast. You know, like, oh, it's over. And no, it wasn't. It was just another really creepy scenario where it's like, oh, that's a close one. Or you see the dead person's hand in the church, in the back of the church, but they just smell it. But you know, kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And they do that a lot. And then they played on this thing. And in the scenery, by the way, was just amazing. I was so beautiful. Yeah. It reminded me of Twin Peaks, actually. Like the waterfall and stuff. I looked it up to see. But what's so amazing about it is like they would say things, for example, like when they're walking across that little kind of rope bridge, right? And he's talking about how easy it is. Well, as the, you know, viewing it, I know that's not easy, and I'd be crapping a load if I was doing that. I'm terrified of heights. The whole idea of that is no way kind of thing. I'll swim. I'll walk miles to get around this. But so he's saying it's easy, and they're going across that, and then he's like, but don't look down because the waterfall will consume you. In other words, like it'll devour you. So then the very next scene, it shows the waterfall crashing against the rocks. So the viewer is drawn into that now, right? Mm-hmm. And then they go back up and they do that interplay back and forth with kind of setting you up and then dragging you down into it, then setting you up and dragging you down into it. And one thing that really I thought was interesting was when they're all around the campfire and it's in the beginning, and Constance, the girl, she's freaked out, paralyzed by fear. And this is at night, right? And she's looking, she's hearing this rustle, and she sees the hand around the tree and stuff. It's totally freaky. And then the dudes come jumping from behind her. They don't come jumping from that side. They come jumping from behind her. Right. And it's like she knows that it doesn't answer the problem. Something is, how did this happen kind of thing. But as a viewer, that paranoia level is now heightened. And so it seemed like with everything in this film, it was just a constant building of paranoia and these little hints that give you like the waterfall, just so many things like this, or walking by a door, but that time the door doesn't open. Just, it was loaded with it. And it kept me on the edge of my seat, man. It was really cool.
You mentioned some of the script that got held over from the book, and that line about why there's so many twins around here. That was obviously a, your little clue for the big reveal later. Mm-hmm. I didn't catch it the first time I saw the movie. I think I watched it a couple times before that's what they were talking about. That's what the meaning of all that was. Cause at the time it seemed out of place. You know, why are they talking about twins other than to say, this is just a lot of inbreeding around here. So
it didn't, like you mentioned, Dan, it did still have some, cliche stuff in there and some mm-hmm. some real cheese in there. And I think that really started when, for me anyway, was when the chick asked her boyfriend to go search the forest for her makeup. It's like, you guys are you kidding me? You know, I think a raccoon may have taken my makeup. Go look for it out in the woods. Oh, okay. I'm on it.
Because there's a chance you'd find it if the raccoon really did take it.
Yeah, exactly. So he just, it's like he knows right where direction to head. I'll just head this way and I'll go looking for it. So yeah, that was like the first kind of like real dumb move.
Yeah.
For the movie that it was, I even thought the acting was pretty decent in that day, mm-hmm. particularly for the final girl, man. She was great.
Yeah.
Oh, Deborah Benson. Yeah. She was really good.
Mm-hmm. And yeah, I thought that, you know, your typical creepy guy, like in Friday the 13th, you know, it's got a death curse. This guy, I mean, there was like two of them really in this movie, where there was the drunk dude, but he kind of had an excuse for being crazy. He just was traumatized, he's in shock, and he's wasted. Mm-hmm. But then you had the popular actor.
Oh, George Kennedy.
Yeah, you had him doing that. And he wasn't like an oddball dude. He even had a cool like character development about him. He was into, you know, bonsai trees and trimming them, and he had a horse and he lived out there.
Mm-hmm. Talk to the horse, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and so it was, Agatha. Was cool. Yeah. I thought all the character development was great. I just, there was something about it that you don't see a lot in movies like that.
I liked his, he didn't have that many lines in it, Kennedy, but yeah. He had the one line where he said, he's warning them off, of course. And he says, the mountain don't read. I like that line because I think you could take it a lot of different ways. And I think in some ways he's referring to the killer. You know, and just, they're just these backwoods and that too, I think is very Halloweenish. That even though there's two killers, there's ciphers. There's absolutely no reason that they're out there killing people other than that they love to kill people.
Yeah.
You know, before the goofiness of Halloween 2 and, you know, Michael Myers and Laurie is really his sister and all that crap. I hated that. I hated that swerve. It was great up until that point. I just hated that storyline because to me, Michael Myers was a hell of a lot scarier as the boogeyman. When we didn't know why the hell he was doing anything that he was doing.
Yeah.
And that's the, you know, the two killers in this. I mean, we watch Friday the 13th. Well, you know, mom's killing because they drowned Jason, but how does she not know that her son is still alive, just kind of swimming around in the lake waiting to get bigger and kill everybody. I'm not, and that I never understood that part. And then he's killing everybody because they killed mom.
Yeah.
You know? And all those other movies are usually based on, you know, something happened at prom or somebody got burned and they come back and they butcher everybody, you know, 20 years later.
Stephen Graham Jones is probably maybe the biggest slasher fan that I know. I mean, the dude is just all of them. He's probably seen this one 20 times, but he said something once about how they're all motivated by revenge. I mean, I'm sure there's outliers. This would be considered an outlier, but the filmmakers probably don't consider it a slasher. Mm-hmm. I mean, if Friedkin can make The Exorcist and say it's not a horror movie, it's a drama, then this guy could certainly make a movie and say it's not a slasher. But of course the term, I don't think it was even a term in 81.
Probably not.
But yeah, if you think about it, so many of those movies, they were like ones that you just been, you know, like Jason, the prom night movies, you know, they're motivated by some type of revenge, whether it's justified or not.
And it's strange too, to look back on a lot of those movies and try to piece together what was going through the director's heads or the writer's heads. They all received the same criticism back then. Besides being crap, they were highly misogynistic. And you can see that in a lot of the scenes where, you know, we've got these full frontal nudity of all the women, you know, or, well, they're supposed to be teenage girls, of course, usually played by 30-year-olds. And yet, for some reason, though they were very exploitive towards these women, they always wound up, or most of the time wound up anyway, with these really powerful final girls who ended up saving the day. Very few male heroes in the old slasher days.
Yeah.
Very few. So I'm not sure how to interpret that. I don't know what they're thinking.
You mentioned earlier about the foreshadowed twins. Mm-hmm. I think there were a couple other things that were kind of interesting in hindsight. Once you've seen it, you go, oh, okay, well, think about this. You have the drunk guy, right? Ty. And to me, that was a real cheesy scenario. You know, what's coming after you? Demons. You know, he's been drinking and he's like, you know, you got to take me with you. And they said, can we take him with us? And it turns into a serious conversation. I mean, people would be avoiding that guy like the plague. It would be a really scary situation out in the middle of nowhere. But they're feeling badly for him. And they said, well, hey, he's really hungry. He's going to starve. And the guy throws some food out for him. And he says, he's going to die, but not of starvation. He doesn't die. I thought it was an interesting thing that scene, that guy ends up dying, right? But not the guy that everybody's kind of thinking he's toast. Yeah.
Because initially you think that this guy's a red shirt. He's wasted.
He's wasted.
He's making an ass of himself. He's gonna die.
Which was great that his laughter when he sees the one of the mountain twins jump on the back of the RV and he's just cracking up. But another one would be the bonsai situation where he's grafting the tree, right? He's talking to himself about minor alterations and not disrupting nature too much. Mm. And yet in the end, he says that this was basically inbreeding, that he says that these people were inbreds. So these were not minor alterations. They disrupted nature dramatically. Okay. Mm-hmm. And I thought that was interesting. I thought it was interesting too, that he named his horse Agatha, which is the etymology of the word, goes back to the meaning good. And it was an interesting kind of horse too. I actually wondered, I was like, I don't know if I'm pronouncing it properly. Camargue. It's one of the oldest breeds. And they say it's related to kind of this prehistoric horse and it's born dark, but it gets white over time. And it looked really similar. I don't know if it's the same kind of horse, but the same color patterns and stuff. And it was just really cool to see that. But the foreshadowing things, I thought it was really interesting. And I didn't get to look and see, because he mentions Gemini specifically. And I meant to actually go into my treasure trove of symbolism and to say, like, well, you know, what's up with Gemini in particular? You know, the use of that specific phrase more than just simply to talk about twins.
They're similar to twins, I think.
Of course. But I didn't know if there was something more, or if when I found out later that it also had to do with this cult and, you know, voodoo and stuff, that maybe it kind of played into some of the symbolism with that.
Yeah. But, you know, the twins, you know, they had the weird sped up demon voices, which I thought was bizarre. Again, without knowing that there was supposed to be some other kind of stuff in there, but their eyebrows, man, their eyebrows, they reminded me, being the antagonists in the film, they reminded me of antagonists, creatures and monsters from early black and white films. They were big on like eyebrow stuff, like as though that was some kind of like Nosferatu, Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, even the original Edison's Frankenstein. All of them had even early test makeup for Reagan in The Exorcist. All of them had huge eyebrows.
Hmm.
So when I saw those guys, as goofy as it looked, I thought it was, and I don't know what this black paint or whatever that they had on their head. I don't know if that was supposed to symbolize maybe part of
smudge.
A cult-like thing, because I think the film was originally supposed to be called something, The Ritual or something.
Almost reminded me of Ash Wednesday.
Yeah.
Yeah, like a smudge, the smudge on that. You know, I know there are other religions that do kind of ceremonies that involve smudges on foreheads, but that was a weird thing.
What are the killer's laughs? Who did that remind you of?
I don't know, like Jigsaw or something, or the.
I kept thinking of Muttley the dog from Dastardly cartoons.
Yeah, those old cartoons. Yeah, yeah, you're right. They sounded weird.
Oh yeah, they did. Weird. And Kennedy too. I liked Kennedy. I liked the way he played his role, but they couldn't say no to him since they got him. But I thought it was a little bit risky considering he was just coming off of Airplane. And I'm not sure that you could see him in a non-comedic role that close to Airplane. I mean, it's hard to take him seriously. And plus he's talking to a horse. So, it's easy for me to watch it now, but I think back then it may have distracted me quite a bit.
I can imagine that. In fact, I kept wondering, I'm like, I recognize this guy from somewhere, you know, I think it was Naked Gun. But when I went back to IMDb and I'm looking at the names and stuff, I was like, oh, okay. I'm like, yeah, I've seen this guy on a bazillion things, man. And so he's been all over the place. And I kind of wondered about him a little bit. Like, some of my favorite scenes for the cinematography involved him, like the one where it's out in the woods at night and you have the moon just glistening off of the creek.
Yeah.
I mean, that's just beautiful. And the horse goes, and I love the transition too, because I was anticipating that he would just kind of walk across the skyline, right? And that exit the scene, and you would just kind of go in and blurry up the stuff. And instead, he comes walking right down with that horse right through the center, this pale white horse right through the center, and stirs up all the sheets of water. So he stirs up all the water, and as it's stirring it up, I started noticing the color change, and then very subtly, I was like, that's like blood red. And then dawn behind him, and I said, what a genius move. That was so good.
I don't understand why Jeff Lieberman didn't end up just knocking it out of the park with some big success after that. He did some really brilliant shit back then, and this movie, I mean, to me, it just he should have, at least if not made it huge, at least directed a major horror movie at some point in the 80s. I don't get it.
Maybe, Universal was originally going to pick this one up. I wonder if things would have turned out way different for him if they had.
Yeah, I'm afraid that if a major company had taken a hold of this, that they may have killed it with a soundtrack. I just love the nature, just kind of encompassing all and taking over the flick. It makes you feel like you can't get away from it.
Not only that, but they could have killed it with a lot of things. They could have been like, well, hey, we need to take a look at Halloween, the success of Halloween, the success of Friday the 13th. We need to do something more similar to that.
Yeah, instead of, you know, Deborah Benson, they end up getting, you know, PJ Souls or something just because she was in Halloween.
Yeah. Or someone who looks like her and talks like her, totally. But we got to talk about the end, man.
Yeah.
I did not see that coming, man. I was so happy to see her punching that dude in the throat, right down his gullet, man.
You're never going to think of fisting quite the same way again.
Oh, I try not to think of fisting anyway, man. Yeah.
It was the ultimate power move by a woman.
It was unbelievable.
Ultimate. Yeah.
It was one of my favorite, other than like Corey Feldman in Friday four. It was one of my favorite, if not my favorite now, demise of the killer. It was great.
It's so memorable.
Did either of you think at the end that maybe it was the sister? That dude was like, you know, double D'ing it like crazy. I mean, he was very well endowed, right? The man who played the part, and he played a number of parts that are probably very similar to that. But originally, I thought it was the sister, the girl, the one singing by the waterfall, which is kind of like a nymph or styled figure, like attracting everybody to the situation and then being surrounded by, fleeing and then being surrounded by death, right? Yeah. So you're bringing them in, wooing them a little bit, even with her ridiculous makeup, which was a hilarious scene, you know. But I kind of wondered, because one of the guys, it was Jonathan, says, hey, is that your sister? And she goes, that's my mom, kind of thing, you know, and plays it off. And then I saw her, and I'm like, it's kind of, you know, it's a young mom. I mean, maybe she was 8 years old. You know what I mean? Like, she had to be pretty darn young. She's looking, you know, pretty ripe. But that was my first thought. But I'll tell you, not only the scene, okay, so you got the scene with the fist down the throat, which is crazy. And I didn't expect that, because so far, the deaths were all kind of, I mean, they were weird, but they weren't extraordinary. You know, it was nothing. I mean, she had it halfway down her forearm into the throat.
Yeah.
And gurgling coming out. It's pretty gross. But you have the scene where the serrated knife, you have the prostate exam, you have the fist in the throat, And then you've got that crazy scene leading up to that with the other twin where she climbs up the tree, right? And she gets up there, and I thought he was going to hack her leg. I thought it was, you know, the back of that leg, kind of like the kid from Pet Cemetery.
Yeah,
we're just talking about that. I'm still checking under cars, man. So, like, you know, the thing is, though, is that I wasn't anticipating him trying to cut the tree down. And that constant thunk, thunk, thunk. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was the timing, the spacing between those swings and that looking up with that face and then blowing the whistle as it's coming down. I was like, man, dude, like, this is so good. And I thought she was a goner. I mean, back flat to the ground.
Oh, yeah.
I said, man, I've seen Man from Snowy River, dude. That dad didn't fare too well. So this lady's got to be just a goner. But she wasn't, you know. And his death, the death of that one, you know, that was like the moment, kind of the rifleman moment, you know, shooting him. So that death wasn't so crazy. But the lead up that you're thinking is going to result in her possibly dying, combined with the fist down the throat, combined with the serrated blade, I said, well, man, crazy. No, it's just insane.
Not only that, but I mean, while she was getting bear hugged by the unibrow demon, and her pussy boyfriend is just like, what was up with that?
Yeah.
I mean, I know he was stabbed, but come on. You know, wasn't even trying. He was just like,
watching.
He's just like watching, and she's dying. Yeah. She's getting killed, man. He's not even. And the only thing I can think of is, you know, there was some foreshadowing toward the beginning where the guys play a joke and they jump out of the woods, and she gets disturbed by that. And she talks about how she was disturbed by the fact that she didn't respond and that she acted like a quote unquote scared baby.
Yeah.
And then she redeems herself at the end big time.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Total badass. And then now who's the scared baby? To the point where he's like crawling toward her and then like just sobbing. And yeah. I understand under real circumstances, a man or woman would probably act like that, just be in hysterics. Mm-hmm. But this is a movie, you know? So mm-hmm. I don't know exactly what the filmmaker was trying to say with that. I mean, we already saw her as being a super powerful woman. Mm-hmm. I kind of saw her like that the whole way. She just had this demeanor about her.
Yeah. She was boss. Yeah.
But then to have this guy, he lost it at the end. He couldn't function or anything.
She's breaking up with him real quick, dude. Like their relationship, it's over,
buddy.
It's over, dude. They could never stay together after that. Never. She'd be like, bro, you stood there. And there was some weird sensual overtone, like undercurrents. Man, there was another reviewer. His name was Pizowell. I'm hoping Pizowell. It's a pretty good review, actually. I think he's got two of them on this. He has one for the Blu-ray and one for another one. But really good, really good, cool channel, actually. And he brought up something that I thought too is that final scene with the fist in the throat and stuff, the way she was moving, and the way the whole thing was kind of going down, that there was kind of a sexual undercurrent. And then when she stands up. And she's got the Dukes on, the Daisy Duke again. She got the Daisy Dukes on.
Wow.
Right? It's true. I miss the style. She does, but she does. She's sporting it. But she stands up like all like super, super sexy, right? And she stands up and she kind of looks over at the boyfriend who's on the ground whimpering like a baby, right? Totally scared out of his mind, traumatized to the point where he's paralyzed, which is what she complained about, that she was like paralyzed. She couldn't even reach for the knife, right? She couldn't even do that. And she stands there, and the camera, as she's coming up, the camera comes up, and then it just fixates on her belly with that nice knot. You know, she's got that cool style where they kind of knot in the front and stuff, mm-hmm. and her Dukes and everything, and those thighs. And it just stops. Like, it doesn't go up and, like, show her face. It just goes, warp, and it stays there for, like, and I said, okay, come on, man. Like, you know, is there some kind of undercurrent here? So I was glad that the Pizowell brought that up.
Plus, she just got done fisting someone.
She did get stronger and stronger as the movie went on. You can see some hints early on, though. I like the juxtaposition too, where you've got like the dude who seems like he's kind of running the show because but all he knows about nature is that he was left a deed, you know, so he's just going to go up there and party. That's all he knows about nature. And she talks about, you know, she's like a rock climber or something like that. So you can just tell that she's kind of for real from the beginning, and all these other ones who are with her are just kind of along for the ride and playing it up that they know what they're doing. But yeah, I love her character. She gets stronger and stronger, and that's about as powerful an ending as I have ever seen in a horror movie.
So Jeremiah, what are your overall thoughts, including a rating for Just Before Dawn?
From the get go, I was in. I liked it a lot, actually, the first 10 minutes. And so I knew from the beginning that it wasn't going to be very difficult to stick with the movie. I thought there were only certain parts that I was like, you know, that's a little bit cheesy or that's a little bit overboard. But at the same time, I'm kind of glad they were there a little bit. Like when they tumbled down the hill. I mean, that was like super dangerous. I mean, you're talking snapping necks and stuff, man.
Yeah.
You know, one person's like, forget this. I'm not going down this crazy deep hill, doing the stairs technique kind of to the side, the safe way, and just tumbles just boom, 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 all the way down. And the other people are like, that looks fun, blur. And they do. And we're talking like really long tumbles. I mean, it's huge. And you're like, and they're tumbling over head over heels like this, man, like tumbleweeds. And I said, dude, there's so many broken bones in this. Like, I was definitely a stunt person doing this. And I said, I'm like, oh boy, I'm going slow down that hill. And so that was a little bit tacky. The scene, you know, about them taking the guy seriously about helping him out, I thought that was a little bit tacky, but it was okay, actually. Like it didn't bother me at all. I didn't feel like any of the characters, even the yokel locals, man, they were in there, didn't bother me. Like, I know that could the movie have done without them? Maybe. But I'm kind of glad they were there. I mean, it almost would be a spinoff. You could say, like, what's up with them? You know, like, what's the background between this crazy inbred family type thing?
I thought that they were great for what they were doing. Oftentimes you see a movie like that, and they're just like they looked authentic. I hate to say it, but they looked like they're not actors. Like, this is really like the people that they chose, the outfits, like the woman with the, you know, her breasts all mashed down by her dress and everything, that's too small for her, and her hair and everything. They looked believable. They didn't look like caricatures of redneck people.
Their IMDb says they've only been in this movie.
Okay, so they probably won't.
They might have been mountain people. You know, they might be mountain people for real, bro. You know, they may not have known a movie was going on. You know, but you know, so there's that. And I have kids, and I like watching movies with kids, and I'm kind of the conscientious guy. And so I don't like watching too many movies with a bunch of, you know, boobs and stuff. We mentioned that in Were-Rooster. So, you know, and I don't mind watching it. We watch it so that other people don't have to. But with this one, I felt that I go to IMDb and I checked out their parental guide or whatever for this, and or somewhere else, it was talking about there's one scene and you can't really tell. That's not true. Okay. You can definitely tell. Okay. But at the same time, it was believable, not gratuitous. It didn't. And if people want to know, I think it's between like 30 and 35 minutes. And, you know, so if
you're referring to her breasts when we're going,
skinny. Yeah, when her breasts are showing, she's skinny dipping, right? He's in his whitey tighties. I thought we were going to have a Were-Rooster moment with him when he turned around after jumping in his whiteies. I was like, oh, dude, it's going to be another one of these, but another dong fest, you know. But the thing is like, even that, it was good. It was perfectly fine. And so if people want to know, you know, there's I think timestamps like 30 to 35 minutes, and they would miss out if they skipped over it. They would miss out on a really great scene where the fondling one, where it's under the water and it's not the boyfriend, and the boyfriend pops up, you know, that's a amazing scene. But overall, man, like the ending, everything, the killings, the bad guy, the crazy locals, the foreshadowing, the cool cinematography, the good acting, the music that was like these natural sounds, plus, man, they had Blondie in there,
you know. Oh yeah,
I was shocked by that. Yeah.
Heart of Glass,
dude, loved it, man. Like, I was like, oh my gosh, this takes me back. I never realized how much she looked like Taylor Swift. But you know, the thing is that overall, definitely enjoyed it. Very few things that I would say, yeah, that's kind of a crappy scene or whatever. And I'd say 4.5. That'd be my rating for
wow.
it. Yeah. Well, but you got to remember, I don't have a lot to compare it to. And so for me, somebody may watch this and say, dude, you gave it a 4.5. And I'd say, yes, I would encourage other people to watch it. Most other people I know, though, have seen a lot of slasher movies. So they might be like, you're in, you know, but I liked it. And I was scared by it. And I loved having the lights off and spooking myself and biting my nails. And so, yes, dude, I would give it that. And I think that people should go and they should watch it if they want to watch a smart, well-acted, scary movie with original kill scenes in it and hardly any and no wildly inappropriate skin. That's what I'd say. What about you, Chad?
I'm so glad that Dan turned us on to this one because I already said that I like it better than Friday the 13th. I mean, I like the idea of Jason when he, once he gets his, you know, mask and stuff or pillowcase. I love those movies. A lot of great moments, but at least for the first Friday, I think this is, I just enjoyed this more. And it's one of my favorite slashers now for sure. I mean, it beats so many out there that I've seen. I've been revisiting and watching ones that I've been meaning to watch since like 84, 85, and just never got around to it. And they're not good, man. There's a lot of them, but they're not good. But like I said earlier, I can watch a movie from that era in that genre and just really enjoy it anyway. But this one was different, and I think it has everything to do with everything that I've already mentioned that I thought was a unique, different take and surprised me in many different areas. I gave it a 3.75 because I'm docking a quarter point for the eyebrows and the laugh.
You pulled a 3.75. If I ever done the decimal with two after it, man, you just last episode, you're like, you and your decimal system.
Yeah, that's like, because,
and then
that's
you say 3.75.
That's because I break down mine down. I break mine down into quarters. You're like, oh. I'll give it a 3.89. I'm like, what?
No, I gave it 2.3 to wear a rooster, but that's because 2.2 sucks. That just the number bothers me a little bit.
Okay. Well, a 3.75. I'm docking a quarter of a star for the eyebrows and the laugh that I didn't quite understand. But I mean, it's if we're talking about slashers and it's just, I have to only rate slashers, it's an easy 4 no matter what. And I would highly recommend anybody who likes slasher movies or 80s, 80s horror, 80s thriller, or any kind of backwoods stuff. For sure. I highly recommend it. So what about yourself, Dan?
Yeah, I think I would probably give it two different ratings based on who's watching it. I think if you're a general horror fan, it probably falls somewhere in the 3.5 to 4 star range. If you are a slasher fan, I think it's a must see. It's probably in the 4.5 star range. Mm-hmm. It's probably in that, maybe not in the top 3, but probably the top 5 slashers of all time. Honestly, it's just a really great movie.
Yeah,
and if you're someone like me who hasn't seen Jack, right? then it's definitely
5.2.
Yeah, 5.2, man. Yeah, that's good, man. Yeah, yeah. It's a good movie though, man. And I'm so glad.
I liked it.
Oh my gosh, like it. Yeah. You know, and it was so cool because, you know, I hadn't heard of any of those. Now I've heard of a lot of movies that I just haven't seen. Right. Or I've seen the previews or I've seen them in pictures and posters and shirts. But these ones, the ones you proposed, I was like, man, I'm like, some of these might be a little obscure. Like, where are we going to find these things? And it is hard to find this one, you know, but people can even go online and stuff. It's in parts and everything. But they, you know, it's so good. And to find something that you'd never heard of and that you just didn't know what you were getting into and you watch it or you kind of have an idea about, well, it's just going to be blood all over the place and it's going to be this and that, and it ends up being smart. and just the dialogue, everything. I just said, man, I said, this is really just, I definitely had a really great time. I'm so glad. And I'm glad that you came on the show, man.
Oh, thank you for having me. I'm glad I was here.
Yeah, dude. Yeah.
Jeremiah, was there anything that while watching the movie after you were done that you felt like, I could really apply this in my life, man. I could really just, I learned a lot.
Yeah, dude. Actually, if I was ever in the woods and I see this super hot chick, you know, singing down by a waterfall and everything, and I see her later, you know, hiding behind bushes and stuff, and I go running up to her, I don't care how hot she is, dude. If she has makeup smudged on the way this girl did, dude, I am booking. Like, I'll be like, look, I don't know what's going on with you, but you know, you look like a serial killer. And so I think I'm out of town because her makeup man was totally jacked. And it's so sad, dude, that she's a butterface like that, because in all reality, dude, she's a gorgeous girl, but that makeup, it's like, you know, it's an innocent thing. I might be able to make excuses to get out of that position and make an exception, but it's unlikely. I'd have to be as drunk as the dude in the beginning. But yeah, so that's my moral, man, is stay away from girls who put on makeup like serial killers. What's your moral there, man?
I learned that it's not a good idea to try and make friends with anyone who has big eyebrows, because behind the scenes, they're probably up to no good, killing people, stealing whistles and stuff. You should probably just stay away from them.
Stealing whistles, dude. Where did you even think? Like, I'm just imagining the type of person, because I can imagine the person with the bushy eyebrows, dude, yeah. And sitting there and like in private, they're looking over at the desk and they're like, dude, look at that whistle. And it's looking pretty dope, that kazoo over there. You know, like, what? Who are these people in your life, Jen?
That's what they do. Stay away from them.
Well, this has been a lot of fun, boys.
Yeah. I want to thank Dan for coming on. He's one of the people that I had written down on a list, one of the first people that I had finally got around to asking him, and I'm glad that he was able to hang out with us and turn us on to an awesome movie.
Yeah, man.
And
absolutely, man. Yeah.
Jeremiah, why don't you tell everybody where they can go and subscribe and all that kind of stuff, or watch us, or
you can find us on Twitter and Instagram and YouTube and even our Gmail. It's all the same. We've made it super, super easy to find us and to send us emails and suggestions, movie reviews, music suggestions, everything, all of that stuff. You can send to paleocheese@gmail.com or find us at paleocheese on any of those different social mediums. Also, I want to say this before we leave. I want to encourage people, go check out Dan's website. It's at danpadavona.com. And you can go see his official website of thriller author. Find out all about him. He's got a whole bunch of really cool stuff there. And you can see the different things that he's written and even his bio and read about the Renaissance Fair and his wife and other things that we never eventually got to get around to talking about. But it's all there.
Thanks for having me, guys.
Of course, man.
Hey, everybody, it's Kevin Goatee.
It's Kevin Israel.
And you're listening to Gutting the Sacred Cow on the Project Entertainment Network. Hey, Kevin, what exactly is Gutting the Sacred Cow?
Gutting the Sacred Cow is a podcast where we invite comedians and talented people every episode to come on and trash a movie that you probably love or someone you know loves.
That's right. Our guests have trashed such films as Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade, Gone with the Wind, Grease, even Star Wars. Can you imagine the balls on that guy? Did he succeed?
I cannot.
Yeah, well, listen and you'll find out. But this is Kevin Goatee and Kevin Israel for Gutting the Sacred Cow.